they will, this is not going to be something they can, most Muslims can't process that stuff. Forget non-Muslims. Basically, our faith boils down to three things. It boils down to three things. Divinity, the divine, right? So there's constantly, there are hints in the Quran that make you reflect and think about whom? Allah Himself, His creative power, His wisdom, His mercy, His forgiveness, etc. The second thing is revelation. The second core concept is revelation. And revelation is a very difficult concept. What do I mean that it's a difficult concept? It's easy to believe in a God. That's not hard. But it's very difficult to believe that that guy over there, an angel came to him and gave him revelation, and now he speaks on behalf of God. Now, for us it's easy because there are millions of Muslims. But when the Messenger first comes and says a revelation has come in, an angel comes to him, and somebody says, which angel? What are you talking about? I don't see anything. No, you can't. It's from the unseen. You have to believe in the unseen. What's the most common response? You're crazy. Isn't that the response in the Quran? If somebody said that to you, what would you call them? I have revelation, an angel comes. Forget the fact that, imagine you lived 3,000 years ago, somebody came to you and said, an angel comes to me, and he gave me revelation, and since you're my neighbor, I feel my obligation to share with you first. You have to believe in what I'm saying, and you have to follow every word I say. Nothing I say is subject to question, because if you question me, it is the same as questioning God Himself. How believable is that? How easy is that for you to accept? You understand? Believing in divinity is easy. Believing in a messenger is difficult. For many reasons. One, because it takes a leap, a serious leap of faith. A bigger leap of faith than Allah. Because the belief in Allah is in the fitrah. The belief of Allah, Allah put in the fitrah. But the belief in a messenger, it comes only to those who respected that fitrah. Only to them it comes easy. Otherwise, the skepticism comes. You know, I can believe in a God. I don't know about this messenger business. I don't know. This guy gets revelation. I can't question anything he says. Everything is perfect. Everything is divine from him. SubhanAllah. So this is the second core concept that Allah talks about in the Quran. We'll talk a little bit about the importance of it, and then come to the third. The first one was what again? Divinity. The second one, revelation. The idea of revelation, meaning it comes to a man and he delivers it. This idea itself is very difficult for people to accept. The third core concept is an afterlife. This isn't the only thing there is to life. There's something more. This is why you should be worried about revelation. Why should I care? Okay, there's a messenger. What's the big deal? What's the harm if I don't really concern myself with this? It's just casual information that doesn't affect my life. It's just another useless piece of information like the back of a Snapple cap. Right? Useless data. What's the difference? What difference does it make? It makes a difference because you, whether you like it or not, you're headed towards this place, you have an appointment, and you can't avoid it, and that appointment is coming inevitably after your death. Right? So the three things, divinity, revelation, and afterlife. And they're connected to each other. They're all logically connected to each other. But here I want to share with you something about how Allah defends the integrity of revelation. Those who believe. At the time of the Messenger, والسلام, you know, when they heard Quran, they came up with different theories of what this Quran really is. One of the most predominant theories was it's magic. That's one of the most predominant theories of disbelief. Is this that Quran is magic? And they would call him sahir. Okay? Inna hadha la sahir wa kadhdhab. No, by them calling it magic and calling the Messenger a magician, they've already accepted that it's not something normal. They've accepted that it's something paranormal. It can't be explained through common sense. And the only thing we can say is, we're not willing to say he's a messenger, so the only thing else we can come up with is magic. That tells you in and of itself that the Quran mystified them. They couldn't justify that a human being can come up with this through common sense. This is something magical. So magic is kind of between, you know, disbelief and belief. It's the state in between. So they've already taken a leap by calling it magic. They called him sahir, they called him a magician, and they called him kadhab. They didn't call him kafir, they called him kadhab. This is Mubarak, Sayyidul Mubarak. What this means is, he's a relentless liar. He's a magician, and he's a relentless liar. Now why would they call him, and by the way, this seems like an insult to the Messenger of Allah, even this is a compliment. Because when they say relentless, what does that mean? What does the Messenger do? He's constantly making doubt. He doesn't stop. When you call somebody a liar, he'll go to somebody else and talk to them because they don't. Every time you talk to them, what do they call you? A liar. Does that stop the Messenger? No. What does that teach you about doubt?
Now, when you're talking to somebody about Islam, he gets a little heated. And he starts insulting you. Right? He says, forget you, I'll find a better customer. Right? Does the Messenger of Allah have better customers? He's always dealing with the same exact people for a decade. Can you imagine? And on top of that, he's dealing with family. Have you dealt with family? How easy is it to talk to your cousin about his son? Or your uncle? Hey uncle, let me tell you something about our hadith. Oh, you're going to tell me about it? Let me tell you about your, right? That's what happens in family. Who is he talking to for 10 years? His family, his neighbors, his neighbor. Can you imagine how tough that is? So, when they called him Sahih al-Kitab, these were actually compliments. One, to the mystifying power of the Qur'an, and two, to the relentless commitment of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. So that's one, magician. Another thing they called him was that he said that he gets his information from jinns. There are two ways of saying it. One is, they call him Majnoon. Majnoon means is the jinn possesses him, also means that, you know, jinn alayhi aqlahu. What it means is that his intellect has been covered up. Because jinn comes from the word janin, which is the room which is covered. Jannah, garden, which is covered up with greenery, and the dirt is covered. So jinn, that which is covered from our eyes, right? So his intellect is covered. So he's gone crazy, basically, right? But there's so that a jinn comes and tells him, shayateen come and tell him. And this was part of their culture. You know, even nowadays in like downtown Manhattan or midtown Manhattan, these corporate executives, when they go make a multi-million-dollar deal, they go see the psychic reader first. Like you can go on Park Avenue, 55th Street, Midtown. Huge multi-million-dollar buildings, and on the first floor there's a psychic reader. How is he affording rent over there? You know what happens? All these executives, they say, what color tie should I wear to the meeting? Like, seriously. Should I wear my lucky pin here or there? And then the psychic reader does whatever, and tells them, yeah, wear this one. That'll be $500, that'll be $2,000, whatever. This was going on back in the day. This is not something new. This was going on back in the day. The Arab would come and say, should we attack that tribe? Should we kill all of them? And the guy would say, hold on, let me tell you. And yeah, you should kill them. Then the shayateen came and told me, because the stars, they came from the stars, they gave me the information, you should kill all of them. Or you should marry that woman, or you should divorce her, or whatever else. So they would come to the kahin, the mind reader, and the one, the soothsayer, they would say that we get our information from where? The stars. So the Arabs, the mythology was the stars, the devils go there, get information, and come back and tell these soothsayers. And this is what Muhammad is doing to Ma'adullah, that what he has to say is just like what these soothsayers have to say. He's just getting information from the devils, that's all it is. Now Allah Azzawajal swears, as we hear in Salah, فَلَا أُقْسِمُ بِي مَوَاقِعَ النُّجُومِ I swear by the placement of the stars. Who placed the stars there? Who knows better about the stars? The one who's sitting in the desert looking at the stars, or the one who placed them there? So he says, those stars themselves are witness that this is a Qur'an. This is a noble Qur'an. That comes from فِي كِتَابِ الْمَفْنُونِ in a hidden book. That's where it comes from. And just to tell you how Allah gives dignity to His revelation, how Allah protects His revelation, the way He speaks about it is so amazing. Just to give you some parallels, so you appreciate how Allah gives, you know, those who believed along the Messenger of Islam, how they understood that this word is something profound. You know, on the one hand you have the Messenger talking to the leaders of Quraysh, who are arrogant. And when you talk to someone, like, you know, a guy is trying to buy a car, and all these salespeople in the parking lot, in the dealership, they all kind of hound around him, can I help you, can I help you, can I help you, right? They're trying to sell him something. Sometimes it feels like that guy is trying to sell someone something, right? And when you try to sell someone something, when you try to convince someone of something, then who's got the upper hand, the seller or the customer? The customer's got the upper hand. So when the Messenger would give da'wah to the leaders of Quraysh, what did the Quraysh leaders feel? They felt they have the upper hand. Yeah, sounds interesting, but you got this blind guy over here, you got these other people here, get rid of them, and maybe we'll listen. They felt like they were in a position to negotiate, right? They were in a position that, you know, give back and forth, work with me a little. But do dhinu, for you dhinu, this is what Allah says Himself. They really want that you give and take a little. Barter with them, trade with them. When Allah spoke about this matter, He said, no. This is not something for negotiation. This is not something wrong. كَلَّا إِنَّهَا تَذْكِرَةً فَمَنْ شَاءَ ذَكَرَةً فِي صُحُفٍ مُكَرَّمَةً مَرْفُوعَةٍ مُطَهَّرَةً بِأَيْدِي سَفَرَةٍ كِرَامٍ بَرَرَةً. This word is way up there in the possession of the most noble of the angels. It's very elevated. You should be honored that you got a chance to hear this word. Instead of you coming here and negotiating, you should know how high this word is. There's no room for negotiation.
negotiation. I don't need to sell it to you. You need it. This word doesn't need you. It's too high above. It's from far above from you. So the Surah Allah illustrates how high the revelation is and how the little people are. So don't ever think that we're going to need to sell. Right? This revelation is too high. Whoever comes to it has only benefited himself, and whoever doesn't has lost on a huge treasure. They were actually honored by even having heard the Quran, because it comes from such a high place. And only the closest to Allah are in company of it. Right? So now this is the place of revelation. But it doesn't just stay there, it comes down, doesn't it?